Question from a non-Muslim sister.
A pleasure. Good evening to everyone here. I'm V. Lakshmi Iyer. So I'm a Hindu and truly believe in Islam. I believe in Islam because I have got some proof from it. So when you said God is one, religion is one, let me take an example of three people, a Hindu, a Muslim and a Christian. Let me take them together, and if their bodies, if suppose their bodies are cut down, what oozes from their body? Only blood, and it's only blood, not the milk, not the water, it's only the blood. When you cut down, only the blood oozes. Why do we differentiate when we depart the body? The Muslims go with burying, and we Hindus, we go by lighting the pyre.
The sister says that she appreciates Islam, she believes in Islam, and I congratulate you and I welcome you to the faith of Islam, submitting our will to Almighty God. The question asked by the sister is that a Hindu, Christian and a Muslim all have got the same body, same blood, same constituent. But when we die, why in Hinduism do we burn the body? Why in Islam do we bury? Let's analyze the pros and cons and you decide which is better. In Hinduism, also they say you can bury the children, etc. But when you become an adult, most of the sects say you have to burn, you have to cremate. There are some sects which say you have to bury. But let's analyze the pros and cons between cremation, that is burning, and burial. If we analyze, in cremation, in burning, sister, there is a lot of pollution. When the body burns, a lot of pollution. In Islam, we have to bury. Why? Because today we have come to know that whatever constituents of the body is there, the earth, the soil, contains the same basic elements of the body in lesser or greater proportion. So from earth we come and to earth we return. Scientific. Comparison, point number one. In cremation, we burn the body, there is pollution. In Islam, when we bury, the land becomes fertile. There's no pollution, there's no burning. Point number two. When you burn, you chop down the trees. Greenery goes down. Environment is being uprooted. In Islam, when we bury, land becomes fertile, more trees grow. It becomes a manure. No chopping down of the trees. Better for the environment. You know, the government says, don't chop trees. If you don't chop trees, how will you burn the human body? Point number three, it is more expensive. According to Indian statistics, every year, crores and crores and crores, hundreds and thousands of crores, every day crores of rupees are spent. Every year, hundreds of crores are being spent only on the trees and burning the body. In Islam, when we bury, it is cheap, free. Point number five, when we burn, the wood becomes charcoal, ashes. In Islam, once we bury in the land, the same land can be used after a few years. It is forever. You can recycle it. The same land, after a few years, when the bones get disintegrated, you can recycle. So logically and scientifically, if we analyze, it is more scientific, more humane, more better for burial as compared for cremation. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Yes, brother, please announce your name first.
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Mayur. I have to ask a question on behalf of my non-Muslim friend. It's not my question. He's feeling shy to come on mic, so can I go ahead?
What is your name, you said?
Mayur. I am a revert, but it's a question on behalf of my non-Muslim friend. He doesn't want to come on mic, so if you allow. Okay. Assalamu alaikum to all of you. His question is, all the prophecies that Zakir Bhai quoted, is it possible that these prophecies were being edited later on in all the various scriptures of the world to preach Islam in a other way? So,
the brother asked a very good question. Can it be possible that all these prophecies were added in all the scriptures later on? Can it be? Yes, it can be. If it is not added, if the scripture is pure, you have to believe it to be the word of God. You have to follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you say it is added, that means the scripture is corrupted. You leave your scripture aside. So if you leave your scripture aside, the only pure scripture is the Quran. Both ways you come to the Quran, head dive in, tails you lose.
Question from the center mic, please.
Okay, good evening. I have one question. Before that, my name is Mr. M. Ramesh Kumar. I am from Mayapur. My profession is pastor. So, brother, in this occasion, you are told the final is Quran. Okay, but I have one question. In a battle of Yamama, my people died. These who bayhatted the Quran, there was a few that Quran can be lost during the Abu Bakr time. And second, Sahih al-Bukhari volume 6, hadith number 510 says, but when third Khalifa came, he was fighting with Harimiya people, and that time this found all the way reading a different Qurans. So Usman retained. And another thing is, Allah says in Quran 15:9, says we have released and we got it. But here the Quran was born, and at the time, what was the corrupted? Why it was the corrupted? Where it was the corrupted? Who is what the corrupted? When it was the corrupted? Please answer me.
Brother asked the question. He says, when the Quran says in Surah Hijr, chapter 15, verse number 9, which I quoted in my talk, that we have revealed the Quran and we shall guard from corruption. So when the Quran says the Quran is uncorrupted, Allah says it's unadulterated, how come Sahih Bukhari says that the Quran was lost at Abu Bakr's time, then third Khalifa Hazrat Usman came and he found different readings, and then how is it possible? Brother, what you said of Sahih Bukhari is correct. What Hazrat Usman, may Allah be pleased with him, found is variant reading. For example, in English language, there are different dialects. Same English language, a South Indian speaks different. What is your name? An Englishman, what is your name? So Hyderabadi has different accent. I can't imitate it. Hindi style is different. My wife was telling me, why don't you speak Hyderabadi style Urdu yesterday? Nakko. In Bombay, we don't say Nako. In Bombay, we say Ayenga, Jayenga, Khayenga, Piyenga. So one of my Bombay brothers said, Ayenga, Gayenga was less yesterday. So here you realize that every area has a different dialect. So same way at the time of Hazrat Usman, in Arabic, may Allah be pleased with him, there were different dialects. What the Prophet gave permission was 7 dialects. So in pronunciation, they made mistakes. So when they made mistakes, he said, okay, let's finalize it. And we have to follow the correct pronunciation. So one of the reasons he did was he corrected the dialect. If someone says, what is your name? An Englishman will say, what type of English is this? What is your name? What's your name? American accent is different. British accent is different. Neutral accent is different. Some accept it, some are not. This was one of the reasons. He corrected the dialect. Number two, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Quran was revealed, he had special scribes. And he told the special sahabas, whatever was revealed to him, he repeated it. And the sahabas wrote down, he rechecked it. In that, Zayd bin Thabit, may Allah be pleased with him, he was the main person, and other scribes. Now, many of the sahabas, when Prophet Muhammad said the Quran, they went home and wrote it through memory. So now someone hears my speech and goes home and makes points. It may be right, may be wrong. It will not be verbatim. But if I tell someone and check up, okay, I'm giving notes, write this, read it again, it's a mistake, correct it. So the copy that was kept with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was verified by him when he was alive. It was given to his wife Hazrat Hafsa, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the daughter of Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him. So it was kept in that custody. Now when people wrote on their own from their memory, there are bound to be mistakes. So the Quran is not wrong. Even though there were notes of some people, Hazrat Usman said, now people should not get misled that that is the real Quran. So he said, okay, now I'll make copies of this and spread it throughout different parts of the world so that they will know this is the authentic. The Quran wasn't changed. People, when they had their own notes written down, people did not know whether that was 100% verbatim correct or not. So Hazrat Usman, the third Khalifa, may Allah be pleased with him, he saw to it that he made a committee of the Sahabas and copied it from the original copy and spread it in different parts of the world. And one of them is even present in Tashkent in Koptaki Museum today. And if you analyze it, it is verbatim same. And today the huffaz, even if you burn all the copies, today there are millions of huffaz who know the Quran by heart. Even if you burn all the copies, hypothetically, yet if these people get together, they can again make the true verbatim Quran. Hope that answers the question.
Any non-Muslim sister?
Good evening to everybody. I am Mrs. Sutapa Sarkar. I am a teacher by profession. With due respect, sir, I wish to ask you a question. How is karma and moksha defined in Islam? And how is it indifferent while in practice?
Sister asked a question that how is karma and moksha defined in Islam? Karma, sister, in the Hindu scriptures means deed.